Hello, I'm Robert, a fact checker and science blogger, and helping people who are scared of many things. So welcome to my channel. And this time, it's about, well, of course, you may have heard the news about the AstraZeneca not working with the South African variant, stopping it. And so, but this is a very positive thing. Look at how quickly the South African cases per day are falling. And so this, for instance, is from January the 30th to February the 7th, and it more or less halved in that time. And this is without a vaccine. And this is just because of public health. And look how it's just going up and up like that. And the only thing they've changed is public health. This is not because of natural immunity. That would not create a sharp turnaround like that. And it's nowhere near the levels where it would. Anyway, it's coming down steeper than it went up. If it was the natural immunity, it would be a normal shaped curve like that. There's no way that that's what that is. So there's no question about it. What's happened there is that there was better public health. And this has been seen around the world, not just in South Africa. And now, if you look at the rate at the halving, so if you've got a certain level of transmission and you manage to block out a certain percentage of transmission, then you'll have a halving rate, just like you have a doubling rate if you've got an exponential growth. And so if you find out how long it took to halve, then it'll halve again and halve again at the same time. And so long as you keep up the same public health measures, it'll keep going down with the same halving rate, just as it goes up for the same doubling rate if it's going up. And so based on that, and it's quite a simple calculation, there's just a calculation there, there's 8 times log, and then divide by another log, and you get that number, which is 95 days. I put the number there, log equals, I should have said n equals 95, so 95 days, and that's how long it'll take to get down to a single case. You can do the same thing with the entire world. And look at how entire world that's turned to peak as well. And that, in that case, if you did it for the entire world, and obviously that's a very long time, but 686 days, short of 2 years, you'd be down to a single case per day in the entire world. Now, of course, we want to go down much faster than that. And there's no reason why we shan't, why we shouldn't. And so I found this End Coronavirus Now website. I've seen it before, but they've greatly improved it. And so, for instance, these are the countries that have already achieved. I've just did a screenshot. And so that's the Holy See, Vietnam, Marshall Islands, Solomon Islands, Samoa, these ones, and Thailand. These have all had zero COVID for at least 14 days, at least one quarantine period. New Zealand has had zero COVID. It's for 4 days, and it's had 4 new cases in the last 14 days. That was in fact the South African variant, and that shows that you can completely eliminate the South African variant. It's been gone for 4 days, and they're likely to have completely eliminated it. It may pop up an extra case or so, and they'll get rid of that as well. And then these are ones, and so you have a kind of ranking, and China's quite a bit way down there because they have an outbreak again. They've had outbreaks from time to time. But the seroprevalence in China is very small. It's something like 4% in Wuhan. It's 0.4 outside Wuhan. It's less than 0.1% in all the other provinces of China. Compare something like 10% in Scotland. And you can see that China has really controlled it, as they said they had. They definitely have. So zero COVID is definitely achievable. A few thousand cases in the whole of China with the vast population it has. And so these are the countries. So then if we go and look at the countries that are doing well, we can look and see how they did. So these are all the ones that are beating COVID, and they've had zero COVID for a number of days. Well, the recent new day, 11 days ago, 18 days ago, Bhutan has had one very recently, but it's very good. It's kept it very low. So it got all these countries, that are New Zealand there, it's one peak there, it's another peak there, and it just has little bits from time to time. Then the others that they classify as really there, and that would include, you see, quite a lot of countries like Bangladesh is really controlling its cases really pretty well. And then if you go and look down at Denmark, they've got, that's good to notice. So in Australia, obviously, going to be down there. India, now I wouldn't be surprised if India, I haven't done the calculation yet for India, but they've been going down since September, and they're now down at 8,000 cases per day, and it used to be 90,000, tenfold reduction in, so that's like quite an easy calculation, September to February, September, October, November, December, January, February, that's 6 months, tenfold. So it would be down, oh no, it's not quite tenfold, 9,000. It's one trick around, it's a bit less than tenfold. So you can see another 6 months it'll be down to 1,000 and so on. It needs to come down much faster than that to reach zero COVID. But it is coming down pretty, it is coming down and down and down. And this is the ones that have done it well, this is how they did it. So these are these 10 methods they've used. Get everyone on board. Impose face mask policies. Now, this was quite a surprise as to how effective face masks are. The CDC reckon that they may reduce your risk of getting it about a quarter of the risk it was without a face mask. And if that's true, then that it really makes a very significant difference, so long as you keep on doing everything else. Social distancing is the most effective of all. So long as you've got good ventilation and you've got physical distancing, I think it's a better word for that, because you still socialise, but at a physical distance. The biggest mistake so many countries have made is that they open up too early. And so many countries have done that. Over the summer in 2020, we were within a shouting distance of zero COVID in Europe, but everywhere opened up too soon. And if we just kept going, even though it was lockdown, even if it was not a very good way of doing it, but if we kept going for another month or so, then we'd been so close to nearly got rid of them, done our test, trace, isolate, done it properly, and we wouldn't have had to go into lockdown again. We'd have been rid of COVID throughout Europe. And the United States could get, so we can do that again. And then all these other things. Quarantine. Now, supported quarantine, that's very important. And New Zealand do that. If you are a native New Zealander, then you get your quarantine in a hotel all paid for you completely. And especially once we get to just a few cases per day, we should all be doing that. New York do that as well. New York give you free quarantine in a hotel. And in New Zealand, you would not be permitted to stay at home if you got COVID. The biggest risk is transmitting it to your own household. It makes no sense. It makes no sense at all. I've been saying this ever since March. It makes no sense at March 2020. It makes no sense at all to, in the United Kingdom, our policy of quarantining at home. Indeed, they didn't even have quarantine. They just gave it up in March. But later on in March, when they started having it again, and they quarantined people together with their household. And that makes no sense. If you possibly can, isolate away from your household. Even if you're taking the very best precautions in your household, you're not going to take as good precautions as a health worker would take in a COVID ward. And essentially, if you've got a COVID patient in the household, your household is a COVID ward. And it just makes no sense if you have the opportunity to send a COVID patient to a COVID hotel, even if it's a mild case, it makes no sense for untrained people at home to keep a patient at home essentially trying to improvise a COVID ward without knowing how to use personal protection equipment properly. And they don't even get someone come in and inspect the home to make sure they know how to look after a COVID patient. And that's the situation that's been in the United Kingdom all along. And the 80% of transmission is in the household. So during lockdown, where you have these, basically we've got thousands of improvised COVID wards where they're taking no precautions at all. And there's a COVID patient in the same household, in a multi-generation household, might be even be 10 people in the house. And it's an improvised COVID ward. That's how you should think about it. It's an improvised COVID ward with no personal protection equipment. The people who care for COVID patients, health worker wouldn't even dream of going to work in a COVID ward without knowing how to use personal protection equipment and being equipped with it. And yet, you have these thousands of people at home, and it's essentially the home has become a COVID ward, and they're not trained, and they're not even trying, many of them. And then the quarantine. If you are a contact of a COVID case, you should be quarantining to protect your own household above all. And so if we do that, it'll make an incredible difference. We're already reducing it this fast without doing that. That's South Africa, that's the world. That's South Africa. And it's not me saying this. The World Health Organization have said what I just said to you. They've been saying that since January 2020. And they've been saying it more and more strongly in February, March. They're just saying all along, and then in all last year, and Mike Ryan says his golden wish would be if in Europe people were to quarantine and isolate properly. He doesn't think anyone is doing that in the whole of Europe. And that would make a huge difference. So we are reducing it quickly, but we're not doing everything. And in China, in February, then they were seeing people with COVID. If you go in with COVID, you get your test within 4 hours. They wouldn't even let them out of the hospital. And they would immediately go to a COVID ward or a COVID hotel. And that's what we should be doing. That's what they do in New Zealand. That's what you do if you take zero COVID seriously. And so we can do that. We can end COVID. We don't even need a vaccine to end COVID. We can end COVID without a vaccine. We still can, and with the variants. That's what South Africa is doing, but they can drop in much faster than that if they do it as thoroughly. And so I'm gradually glad to see that gradually the United Kingdom at last is beginning to do the contact tracing a bit more thoroughly. And they expect to knock between 0.6 and 0.8 points off the R0. That'll make a huge difference. They will achieve that by March, just by contact tracing. And they are still not doing contact tracing anything like adequately, because they aren't doing supported isolation, they aren't doing supported quarantine, and they aren't offering the possibility or even explaining the point in isolating away from your household. So I do see that gradually, as the world begins to realise. So China knew right away they had to do that. The reason is not because they're authoritarian, not because they're single party, because in 2002-2003 they did a hopeless job with SARS. It's because of previous experience of SARS. And same with Taiwan, it's because of previous experience with SARS. Now, we have previous experience of COVID from the first wave. I think that, plus the variants, plus having Biden as president, which really changes the situation, you don't have this conflict. Whenever you have conflict, of different views about how to deal with it, people seeing different images on television, then you get a chink that the virus exploits. And having a consistent world picture and the administration wearing masks in the United States and the whole world, the United States president gets so much press coverage and he's wearing a mask. That alone, as an icon, makes a big difference to the world. Just that the president now wears a mask. Always. And is careful. That shows respect to the science works. So I do think that we're going to gradually, the vaccine is just an extra addition to all that. And there are some issues with the AstraZeneca, some issues with the other vaccine, but they still think AstraZeneca will greatly reduce severe disease and death, even in South Africa. It's not just wishful thinking, it's based on the science and looking at what AstraZeneca does to the samples of blood with antibodies to the South African variant. They think it's very likely eliminate, sort of greatly reduce the severe disease, even though it doesn't seem to work with the milder symptoms. So we should see the deaths and the hospitalizations greatly reduced. We can control this eventually with drugs and therapeutics, but we can do the moonshot of zero COVID, and there's no reason why we shouldn't do it. Now, there's no way that China or New Zealand or Australia are going to just say, oh well, the United Kingdom has gone for just letting it go endemic, so therefore we'll drop all our quarantine, we've got to join them. It's not going to work like that. It's going to work the other way. And so South Africa maybe eventually reaches zero COVID. One country after another will reach zero COVID. Once a country has reached zero COVID and set that target, they're not going to go back again. They're not going to start make it endemic once you've got rid of it. They'll set up corridors with the other countries that have zero COVID. And then other countries, bit by bit by bit, they will cotton on and they will say, well, look, if South Africa achieves it, then that will show that a country with a very porous land border can still do it. And gradually, bit by bit, parts of Africa, they're quite well set up because Africa has controlled it reasonably well compared with Europe. And so this Africa actually it does have a reasonable chance, and then India. So it's just eventually at some point we'll have zero COVID India, we'll have zero COVID United States. That's how I see it happening. The World Health Organization say that let's aim first for very low cases per day. And let's aim for, and then managing it with therapeutics and with the vaccines. But once we get to very few cases per day, then we should put everything we have at those few cases. And for instance, United Kingdom is running at 400,000 case vaccinations every week. This means that last summer, when we had a hotspot in the city of Leicester, which has 100,000 people, then with our current technology, if you could put that back into the last summer, we could vaccinate the entire city of Leicester in just 2 days with their first dose, and then another 2 days, 3 weeks later, 4 weeks later, with their second dose. So once we are down to just a few cases per day, and we could do that much faster than we can vaccinate everyone. So the United States if we look at 100 days to reach one case per day in South Africa, and it would like to take a lot longer, just to do very, very fast vaccination to get that far to vaccinate everyone. But they could do it much faster than that. There are 3,000, then if it is as fast as New Zealand, tenfold reduction in 25 days, and you could do faster than that especially with the vaccine, then in 25 days you'd be down to 300, not 25 to 30, not 25 to 3, so that's 75 days. And rather big, that would, actually they're not far off the South African speed there, considering how high up they are, but it'd be a bit faster. And you could do even faster with the vaccine, because the vaccine, if the vaccine stops, if you are managing to halve the cases in, say, 25, let's say, in say 28 days, then if you can stop just half the transmission with the vaccine, then you can halve half the cases per day in just 14 days. And if you can do 3/4 with the vaccine, you do it in just 7 days, you can halve the transmission if you do everything else on top of the vaccine. So that's how it works, that the vaccine, and then if you don't need to target vaccinate everyone, if you manage to get it down to the way it was last summer, where you've just got a few hotspots here and there, where the vaccine are, you just need to vaccinate the hotspots. So I think things are looking very good, and that zero COVID is well within reach. So I've got that article about it. There's the these things you can read up to find out more. There's the End Coronavirus Now. There's the article I just did there, and then I go into quite a lot of detail in this other article here, which I can bring up. That same for the moonshot of zero COVID. Now there we are. That's that one. I think I've done everything there. So I'll stop because I want to keep these fairly short. But oh, yes, these are, this. Well, just to say this last thing, these are all the times that in February 2020, and this was just never reported. I never saw the BBC in the United Kingdom report this. But throughout February, throughout January and February, the end of January, and especially in February, the second half of February, the World Health Organization was saying over and over again, notice how he says here, you'll get sick of me saying that the window of opportunity remains open, that's open to completely eliminate COVID. And he said, maybe you're tired of me saying window of opportunity, but there's a window of opportunity. So I listened to every single one of those press briefings. And he was saying over and over again, there's a window of opportunity to end COVID. He said that all the way through February, all the way through to March. He only stopped saying that just the day before the United Kingdom decided to move from the contain to the delay phase. That's when he stopped saying that. But the journalists, they didn't report that properly at all. They just kept saying that the World Health Organization has not yet declared this to be a pandemic. Why aren't they doing that? There's lots of pressure on them to declare the pandemic. And then they still haven't declared the pandemic. They still haven't. They didn't explain the reason, which was the World Health Organization's view was that we have lots of localized outbreaks that can all be stopped. And so they didn't declare the pandemic because it could be stopped, because they said the lots of localized outbreaks, this isn't a pandemic. And it's not an alert level. The word pandemic is just a word. But they didn't want to use the word pandemic because from previous experience and ideas of flu pandemics and so on, they thought if they use the word pandemic, then people will stop thinking that they can eliminate it. So that's why, and you have probably heard those news stories about saying World Health Organization still digging their heels in, and despite lots of experts asking them to call it a pandemic, they won't. Well, that was what was going on. If you listen to the actual press briefings, the World Health Organization was saying, there's a window of opportunity, we're not going to call this a pandemic yet, because we can eliminate it. And this was just never reported. The BBC never once reported, that I saw, that the World Health Organization was saying that it can be eliminated. And the politicians in the United Kingdom, they don't follow. I don't think many people follow the press briefings. They have a few thousand views per press briefing on YouTube. Over the whole of all the different platforms, I'd be surprised if in February especially, they get more now. I'm surprised they had as many as 10,000 people watching the press briefings in the entire world. The rest were dependent on the journalists, and the journalists were not reporting the press briefings correctly. And the United Kingdom, I don't think the government of the United Kingdom was aware of what the World Health Organization was saying in the press briefings, or they didn't pay any attention to it. And the advisers, and then I was very surprised to see that New Zealand independently came up with the idea of going for zero COVID. They were listening to the United Kingdom. They clearly were not aware of any of this. The experts I'm talking about in New Zealand, even experts, expert epidemiologists, most of them were not watching the press briefings. The people in New Zealand, so New Zealand originally was aiming for flattening the curve, just like the United Kingdom did, because that's what you do with flu. They said, the best we can do is flatten the curve. And then they saw the cases per day going over and coming down. They said, oh, this is unusual. This is nowhere near the flattening of the curve. It wouldn't have come down. Where are we? Here I've got a picture for New Zealand. If they were flattening the curve, it wouldn't have come down until they had reached nearly the entire population. It would be going up and up and up, and gradually for months and months and months, and eventually started to come down. But instead, they saw it coming down. This flattening the curve can't do this. This sort of a thing. It just can't be done with flattening a curve. Flattening the curve just keeps it going up and up until eventually nearly everyone has got it, and then it starts going down. So they said, wow, something strange going on here. And then they said, well, maybe we can aim for zero COVID. If I understand right, that's why New Zealand, what happened with New Zealand. They were originally aiming to flatten the curve, and then they discovered the Bruce Aylward's report from China, the joint WHO China mission. And then they said, why aren't it's rather amusing if you've watched all these videos from the World Health Organization, but New Zealand said, do I have the quote from them? You know, why aren't they, one of the things that surprised me throughout is that the World Health Organization in particular, who was obviously very closely engaged with China and observed the experience of Wuhan in basically eliminating transmission, have really not pursued this focus on elimination since then. And this is an expert, so he clearly hadn't watched all these press briefings. And so New Zealand then, they said, well, we can get to zero COVID. So they did it. And they followed the Chinese example. And then they were very surprised. They expected the rest of the world to follow their example. And so they had the same rather strange experience that the World Health Organization had, that they were telling the rest of the world, look, we've stopped it. World Health Organization was saying, look, China and Taiwan have stopped it. Everyone can stop it, but nobody listens. And the reason is because they just got stuck mentality that this is like flu. They're used to flu. It's just the way human beings are. We get stuck in our thinking. It takes quite a lot to shift your thinking. But hopefully, with the first peak, and then the experience of coming down on that, and the experience of how bad it is, and then the experience that test, trace, isolate, they're just gradually learning with the second peak. Yes, test, trace, isolate really does work. It really, really does work. So I think that gradually we are going to be learning the same lessons that China learnt 10 years ago from SARS, and Taiwan learnt 10 years ago from SARS, nearly 20 years ago, sorry. Then I think that the rest of the world is gradually learning this. Plus, New Zealand never had SARS. I don't think they even had any SARS cases in New Zealand, but they were just very flexible and nimble in their thinking, and their Prime Minister was very courageous. It takes a lot of courage when you're down to nearly zero cases, to just not spread. It's very difficult. You can't blame these people for letting up, to reopening too early. It's a natural thing to do. Once you're down to just a few cases per million, then your population is saying, well, look, our risk of infection is almost zero now. Why are we still doing the physical distancing? Why are we still wearing masks? Why can't we just go back to normal? And it takes a very courageous politician to say, we've got to stick the course, like Jacinda Ardern did. We've got to stick the course for another 4 weeks. Just wait for another 4 weeks or another 8 weeks if you're down to nearly zero cases per day. If you've got to zero cases per day, we've got another 4 weeks to quarantine periods. Just stick. I know it's, it seems so frustrating. You think that if you go back to normal, your risk of getting it is almost zero. But the payoff is absolutely huge. Go another 4 weeks and then you've got rid of it. And then you can completely let up. And there's no longer any risk of getting it. So that is the difficult decision that many countries now have to do, one after another, if we want to eliminate it. If not, then they are part of the endemic fraction of Earth's population, where we continue endemic. And then I don't see China or New Zealand or Australia letting it be endemic in their populations. So we will either have a permanent division, where gradually one country after another goes to the COVID-free zone. You'll never get anyone going the other way. But gradually, one country after another will go into COVID-free zone. And once it's in there, they'll stay there. So either over the next few years, decades, it either gets so, so mild that it's like a cold, and then maybe eventually China says, oh, well, it's just like a cold, we can let it in. Or else, but if, as long as it's as serious as flu, then why would a country let another disease like flu into their country? So I think it's inevitable that we're going to be aiming for zero COVID. That's my own personal view. I haven't seen anyone else say that, but it just based on that it's a one-way process, that the countries will transition from endemic to zero COVID. I can't see any countries going the other way. And if we get another large population like United States or like India going to zero COVID and joining, if India joined China, and then if United States also joined India and New Zealand and China and Taiwan, then that would be getting on for half the world's population would be zero COVID. Then you get more and more momentum. Germany, I know, is a big movement in Germany of people who want to go for zero COVID. So if Germany went to zero COVID, and Denmark, say, went to zero COVID, then they won't want to go back again once they've reached zero COVID, and they'll have borders and quarantine. And then gradually the rest of Europe will say, well, what do we do? Do we go for zero COVID, or do we go with the United Kingdom and with it endemic? And one country after another, I think, is going to go for zero COVID. And nobody is going to go back again. So I think we're going to end up with zero COVID. That's my own reasoning. What do you think? Do you think I've got that right? Or do you think I missed something here? Anyway, whatever it is that happens, then so do say in the comments or PM me or let's talk it over in the group and Doomsday Debunked or whatever ideas you have on that. But anyway, so these are the actions to get to zero COVID. We know how to do it. We've got pioneer countries that have already done it. And I think we're going to head for COVID, zero COVID. That's my personal view. But we'll see. In any case, it's going to be a lot better in spring. By March, April, then we will have deaths and hospitalizations will be going way, way down. And that'll make a huge difference to the way people think about it, be much less scary. And then we also got many really good therapeutics coming along that look really promising. Now, you get you get therapeutics, get people advertising and saying, oh, this therapeutic's based on a small trial of 30 people or 50 people or something that looks as if it works. Sadly, that's a very common thing. If you've got lots and lots of people testing lots and lots of therapeutics, then just by chance, some of them will happen to seem to work, especially small numbers like 30. Those people were going to get well anyway, and then they just happened to give them the therapeutic before they got better. And then they say, look, well, and many people have a short thing anyway. And so just had all the different people testing many different things around the world, and then just by chance, someone happens to give this drug to people just before they got better, and they think it's the drug that did it. And so you have to watch out for things like that and various other confounders. But that's why we need the proper clinical trials. But there are lots of very promising drugs, and some of those drugs, in these small trials, then it may not be an accident. It may be that it really is. And there's some that look very promising. There are over 50 now in these trials of therapeutics. One way or another, and that's the World Health Organization's opinion, not mine, one way or another, it's likely to be greatly tamed. And with the vaccines, then the vaccine manufacturers, they're very agile. Our science is very fast now. The messenger RNA vaccines, we've got so many new vaccines also in trials. And one way or another, this is going to be very much tamed later in the spring. And by the summer, I do expect it to be greatly reduced symptomatic cases per day, greatly reduced hospitalizations, greatly reduced deaths per day. With the COVAX Alliance, we are going to vaccinate around the world, the entire world vaccinated in the same year. Never happened before. It'd be much better if they're all vaccinated in the same month or even the same week. But we are going to have at least all the healthcare workers, all the people with all the vulnerable people, hopefully started vaccination in the spring everywhere. And with a big push, we could vaccinate them all in the spring, but probably more like the summer. But by the end of this year, then everyone who's vulnerable will certainly have been offered a vaccine. And every health worker in the entire world. So the really amazing things going on. I mean, looking back, that's never been done before with any vaccine. And then looking forward, we can eliminate COVID. If we eliminate COVID, and then so the way that Mike Ryan put it in the social media Q/A a week ago, then he said, let's aim for the few cases per day back to where we were last summer. And then once we've got there, then do we go for the moonshot of eliminating COVID? And then if so, what about eliminating a number of other diseases at the same time? So we could have multi-vaccine shots around the world. Why just eliminate COVID? We could eliminate measles, mumps, rubella, polio. You know, why not really make for a real moonshot and eliminate all the eliminable diseases that can be eliminated with a vaccine, which is a lot. And if we did that, that big moonshot, it wouldn't, you know, if you're taking the vaccines, delivering the vaccines anyway, I suppose it'd be more complicated. You've got all these different vaccines, some will have different protocols, and you may be able to do multi-vaccine doses of some sort, but that is a possibility. Certainly we've got this, with the political will and with enough finance, and we could just have a big project to vaccinate the whole world, everyone who wants to, against a dozen different viruses, diseases, and eliminate them all from the entire world. That's scientifically within our reach. It is politically, it's financially within our reach. It would be a very low price. You know, it would cost, I don't know, you're talking about billions, not trillions. this is something we could do. We could do it by 2030, we could do it by, say, 2025, that the world could have eliminated many of the most serious diseases, all the ones that can be eliminated with a vaccine. And so that was just something that Mike Ryan just made as an offhand remark in the social media Q/A. But I just want to shout out to it and just say, you know, this is within reach. This is something for much less than the amount that we've spent on the various COVID recoveries so far, the various COVID defeating things. And it would be a stimulus, you know, that's employing lots of health workers, employing lots of vaccine manufacturers. We need to stimulate the economy. Why not stimulate the economy with a moonshot to eliminate half a dozen or a dozen diseases from the entire world? What better stimulus could you have than that? All the people who would be employed in that project. And then the best recovery comes from a stimulus that has very long lasting effects. And those diseases, they have a big effect on the world economy. So many people dying of them world round and many others in hospital. I mean, a world without measles. A world without smallpox. Without polio. It already is a world without smallpox. Just completely gone. And many other diseases. So this is within our reach. It's almost there, you can almost touch it. Just within a few years. Anyway, so I'll upload this now and then put it up on Facebook, on YouTube, and share it. So just a shout out for Doomsday Debunked on Facebook, where we help people who are scared of many things. If you're a good fact checker, we very much welcome you there. It's really great to see more people fact checking there. We've got the usual fact checkers have been there, the stalwarts that have been there for a year, 2 years, and now we've got quite a few new people joining, and that's really great to see. And so do check the rules at the end of the group. It really helps it to function properly. And also do join if you're scared. And the main thing about fact checking is just that you use reliable sources. And we just find the actual facts for people. And it's particularly fact checking things that scare people. And that's our job. And anyway, maybe see some of you there, either as fact checks or as fact checkers or scared people. And very welcome to our group and welcome to this channel, and do like and subscribe. And I know I get very few people watch these videos, but the few people who do appreciate them. And so I know that they are appreciated. And then I add them to my articles, which get many more views. And then some of those can then watch this video to get more detail about these things.